Hello everyone, I am Bob and this is the Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining channel. In this build episode, I'm going to show you my current progress in getting my DCX Bitpod tank to work with my existing immersion setup. So with that, let's get started. Okay, so in my last build episode, I covered unpacking, initial setup, and my initial impressions of the DCX Bitpod system. And so in this episode, I'm going to show you my progress in trying to integrate the Bitpod tank into my setup. Now, I am an engineer by trade, and so as I built this into my system, I made a few alterations along the way. And the first of these changes to the out-of-the-box or off-the-pallet Bitpod system is to improve the tank insulation. As I noted in a previous episode, my mining room has limited ventilation. Any heat building up in my room is just going to turn that room into a sauna, and so I need a well-insulated tank. The Bitpod tank has a double-wall design, which is a great start, but I figured I could improve that with a small change. I had some 1/4-inch thick garage door insulation and aluminum tape left over from my first tank design, and this insulation is the perfect thickness to fit in between the inner tank and outer shell. So I flipped the tank over, removed the 12 screws attaching the outer shell to the inner tank, and remove the outer shell. I covered three sides, the bottom, and the lid of the tank with insulation to help hold the heat in. Now, this isn't enough to perfectly insulate the tank, but it was an easy thing to do and was better than nothing. I reattached the outer shell over the insulation, flipped the tank right side up, and set it in place in my mining room. So here in my mining room, I have the Bitpod tank right side up, full of fluid, and ready to run. I've been running the system now for several weeks, but I've only been able to run one miner, and I'm going to get into that a little bit. For right now, I'm going to cover what it took to get everything up and running. And the first thing to talk to is the weir plate between the main tank and the hot coolant recovery. I had to play with that quite a bit to get it to where I want it to be. The Bitpod tank comes with a single black plate, bolted in place, ready to go. I started off with this plate, and it places the fluid level very close to the top of the tank. Now the Bitpod kit comes with plenty of ThermoSafe R to fully fill the tank and make it over this level. However, I really didn't like it that high. It didn't give me a lot of room to route cables above the fluid. Now this black plate is actually made to be separated into two pieces. It's laser cut down the middle with a couple metal tabs holding it together. You just bend it back and forth and the plate separates. And this gives you the flexibility of using only one plate, which brings down that fluid level. Now, that fixes the fluid being too close to the top, but it introduces a new problem. And that is that the coolant pump is located right underneath the hot coolant recovery. And when you only use half of that weir plate, you're bringing the fluid down very close to the inlet to that pump. When I ran that pump at full speed, sometimes a vortex would form. This would suck air into the pump and into the fluid. And air into your fluid is a bad thing. Little bubbles get into your miner, they attach to hot surfaces, and those can create hot spots which can actually damage your mine equipment. Now, I found a really quick fix to this, and that is to simply use one of the squares you cut out from your flow plate and just kind of bend it into this shape. It's roughly an inch high, with four little legs and a bunch of open space. I put this over the entrance to the pump. It allows enough fluid to go into the pump, and it stops that vortex from forming. And this worked really well. So if you're seeing a similar problem with your system, maybe that's an idea you can use. Now for me, that fixed the vortex problem, but the lower fluid height in the hot coolant recovery section caused a little bit of another problem that I have to deal with. And that is you don't have a lot of flexibility when it comes to the fluid level in your tank. When you start up the system, you'll have the fluid level in the main part of the tank all the way up to the plate and enough fluid in that hot coolant recovery section to fully feed the pump. Now, as your system heats up, the fluid expands, and it expands quite a bit. And so what happens is that hot coolant recovery section slowly fills up until it's level or a little higher than the fluid in your tank. Now, that's pretty easy to fix. Just grab a small plastic cup or something and dip fluid out of the tank until the hot coolant recovery level dips below the plate. Now, for most setups, that's going to be just fine. Adjust the fluid level and then just let everything run nonstop. However, for my setup, I'm going to be starting up and shutting down the system repeatedly to do all sorts of things like overclocking, miner flipping, and other things for this channel. And so for me, adding and removing fluid every time I want to start the system up and shut it down, that's going to be a real pain. So for my system, what I decided to do is just build my own plate. I used those black plates as a template, and I chose a level midway between the half plate and full plate design. With that plate design, I'm able to fill the tank once. As the fluid heats up, it still stays below the plate level, so I will be able to start up and shut down my system repeatedly without having to add and remove fluid every time I do that. Now, the next modifications to the tank deal with integrating with my control system. As I've covered in past episodes, I'm a huge fan of having a control system running your miners. And as you saw in past episodes, having one in place really saved me. When my tank leaked, it shut everything down and prevented damaging my miners or my pump. Now, the Bitpod system is made to run out of the box without a control system. And that's because DCX spends a lot of time fabricating these systems to ensure that the pump, heat exchanger, and all connections aren't going to leak or fall apart. But even with that fact, I still wanted to integrate my control system just because it's really been a good thing in my past. Now, in my old system, I had a flow switch between the pump and the heat exchanger to detect any type of pump failure or system leak. Now, I can't insert that type of flow switch here. That would mean ripping apart all the lines between the pump and the heat exchanger, and there's just not enough room down there to fit the flow switch in. So instead, I decided to go with a level switch. This switch sits in my hot coolant recovery, and this type of switch is normally used in chlorine pools. This switch is made to handle chlorine environments, so it should handle the dielectric fluid well. I attached the switch to my tank using some sheet metal and some pop rivets I've had from a past project. The other part of my control system was a thermal switch I had between the tank and the pump. Now again, I'm not going to rip apart the system and try to insert that, so I had to find a different way here. So all I did was punch a couple holes into the lid of the tank, again used some sheet metal and some pop rivets, and made a location that will hold my thermal switch above the tank. This positions the switch to be in the fluid right above my miners, which is going to be the hottest point of the fluid in the entire system. With all my control systems hooked up, the next big question to ask is what to do for my glycol water cooling system. Now here, I decided to stick with my existing design. I already had the pump, the dry coolers, my interface with my home heating and hot water, and all the piping laid in place, and I didn't want to rip all that out and rebuild it. Now reconnecting my glycol water cooling system with the tank was really easy. I just used a couple 1-inch hose barbs and connected it to the existing tank using the hose provided. Now once all of this is in place, the next steps are to put the miners in, fill it with fluid, and get your cables routed and set. Now for filling the tank, once again, I really recommend getting yourself a drill pump. These are very cheap and they're super handy to have around your mining system. It makes it very easy not to splash this oily fluid over everything. Now as for attaching cables, this is where I think the Bitpod tank has a really cool feature. They've welded on a few tabs towards the coolant recovery side of the tank, and these are great locations to use zip ties to pull your cables up and out of the way. With all of that in place, I was ready to mine Bitcoin, and this is where my problems with the Bitpod system started to happen. In my previous tank design, I had two S19 miners running at stock speeds. I ran these for 3 days straight. I ran my water glycol coolant system at its lowest pump setting, and the fluid exiting the miner never got above 115 degrees Fahrenheit. Fan on my dry coolers often turned off because it had plenty of cooling power to dissipate the heat. All of these components worked great together, and if it wasn't for a leak in my tank, I'd still be using that system mining with two miners. Now, when I started up the Bitpod system, I hit a snag really quickly, and this is a major issue I'm going to have to fix. When I turn on both of my miners, the fluid in the tank quickly heats up. After about 30 minutes, the fluid temperature gets up north of 140 degrees Fahrenheit, and eventually one of my miners shuts down. And so right now, I'm only able to run one miner nonstop with this system. Now, the Bitpod system is made to run with two miners, even with overclocking, without a problem. And my coolant system has demonstrated it can handle two miners with no problems. So what's going on here? Well, I started playing with my system to try and figure out why it was overheating. Now, in my previous design, my flow plate had a fairly open arrangement, and I was using Bitcool. So I decided to try that here. I removed the restrictive flow plate, and I replaced the fluid with Bitcool, and that really didn't change anything. Everything was still overheating in roughly around 30 minutes. Now, in my previous system, I had a different pump,
for my dielectric fluid, so I thought maybe it was pump speeds. So I altered the pump speeds both on the coolant side and the dielectric side, and again, no difference. The system was still overheating. So at that point, I realized I'm going to have to take a step back and really look at what's going on here.
When I went through my system design process, I had to take into account all the different components of my system and how they work together. In my setup, I have an extremely long piping run between my mining room and my dry cooler setup outside my house. My dry cooler radiators are set up in series so that the fluid goes through each radiator sequentially. And I also have a mixing valve at the dry cooler, which is there to prevent overcooling in the winter. All of these components create a fairly high resistance to fluid flow in my glycol water cooling loop. In fact, here is my calculated head loss curve. This shows how much additional pressure is needed to increase the fluid flow in my system. As you can see, it's fairly steep. It takes a lot of additional pump pressure to move more fluid through my glycol water cooling loop. Adding the pump curves from my installed pump shows the estimated flow rate I was getting through my system. When it came to picking out the brazed plate heat exchanger for my system, I used these flow rates to make sure I had the right size and right type of heat exchanger to move enough heat from the dielectric fluid to the glycol water loop. I had designed all my components to work together in my immersion system, and I think this is the source of my overheating problems. Just like in my system design, all of the components in the Bitpod system are also designed to work together. This system is designed to have the Bitpod tank and ICP15 dry cooler directly connected by a large 1-inch hose without additional components between them. This kit comes with about 60 feet of hosing, meaning the tank and dry cooler are intended to be less than 30 feet from each other. By comparison, the distance between the tank and dry cooler in my setup is at least twice that distance. The pump in the DCX ICP15 dry cooler is a lot larger than my pump, and although physical size isn't everything, I have no doubt that the pump curve for that pump is substantially higher than for mine. Now, I don't have all of the detailed design information for the Bitpod system, but my guess is that the heat exchanger built into the Bitpod tank was designed to match these other components. It wasn't designed to be compatible with my glycol water cooling loop. And so my thinking is my pump is not pushing enough fluid through the heat exchanger to pull enough heat from the tank. And this is highlighting the risk of buying pieces of different systems and trying to get them to work together. If you are looking into the Bitpod or any other commercially available system, it's probably a good idea to buy the complete system with both the tank and the dry cooler. If you try to piece it together with other components, you might run into problems like I have. So, what can I do? Well, one option is to just install a new pump capable of pumping at a higher pressure and try to force more fluid through my glycol water cooling loop. Now, with the steepness of my system's head loss curve, there's a limited amount of extra fluid flow I'm gonna get, but I figured it was worth a try. So I reluctantly bought a brand new high head Bell & Gossett pump. Looking again at the pump curve and head loss curve, it showed I might be able to get a few more gallons per minute through the system, and I thought maybe that might be enough to keep my system cool. So I installed the pump, turned both miners on, and well, it took a little longer to heat up, but it still is overheating. I still can only run one miner at a time. So now I'm stuck with two options to fix my system, and neither of these options are very great. The first option is to completely redesign and rebuild my entire glycol water cooling loop to integrate in the DCX ICP15 dry cooler. The problem here is I'm not sure this is going to work. I can't shorten the distance between my dry cooler and my mining room. The lines have to stay as long as they are. Also, I have a heat exchanger and other components in this loop, which I'm using to deliver heat to my house. I don't want to remove these, and these add even more resistance to the fluid flow. So I might spend a ton of time, money, and effort rebuilding everything, and I still might have a fluid flow and overheating problem. And that brings me to my second option, the one I've chosen, and the one I'm really not looking forward to. And that is to rip apart the Bitpod tank pump and heat exchanger assembly and replace the provided heat exchanger with the heat exchanger I designed to work with my glycol water cooling loop. The reason why I really don't want to do this is when DCX builds these systems, they use joining techniques to ensure there are no leaks in the fluid connections between these components. These joining techniques are not meant to be undone. And so if I pull these apart, there's a good chance these fittings aren't going to be easily reusable. Rebuilding my dielectric cooling loop might be a nightmare when it comes to getting a leak-free build. But I think it's the best path forward for me, and when I do rebuild the miner cooling loop, I think my whole system will work together as designed without any major problems. Now, this video is getting a little long, so I'm not going to get into covering my other progress I've made on my dry coolers. In a future build episode, I'm going to show you how I fixed my noise problem and made my dry cooler ultra quiet. I'll also show you some noise measurements I've made on the DCX ICP15 dry cooler to see how they compare. In the next design episode, I'll be completing the design information on heating your house and getting into heating hot water with Bitcoin. There's a ton of more great Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining episodes coming your way. And so for now, bye.